everybody doing?
Good.
All right. I want to share some thoughts that I wrote down. You know, it's been said several times this year in this church that this is a time of declaration, that we need to declare those things that we want to come to pass in our lives, in the lives of those around us. You know, to declare the things that the Lord has said. So for the past few weeks, I've been hearing the Lord telling me that I have to speak about the river, but I didn't know what. All I know is that the same two scriptures came popping up over and over, Ezekiel 47 and Revelation 22. So I want to read you from Ezekiel 47 first. It says, "Then he brought me back to the door of the temple, and behold, water was issuing from below the threshold of the temple toward the east, for the temple faced east. The water was flowing down from below the south end of the threshold of the temple, south of the altar. Then he brought me out by the way of the north gate and led me around on the outside to the outer gate that faces toward the east. And behold, the water was trickling out on the south side. Going on eastward with a measuring line in his hand, the man measured 1,000 cubits and then led me through the water, and it was ankle deep. Again, he measured 1,000 and led me through the water, and it was knee deep. Again, he measured 1,000 and led me through the water, and it was waist deep. Again, he measured 1,000 and it was a river that I could not pass through, for the water had risen. It was deep enough to swim in, a river that could not be passed through. And he said to me, 'Son of man, have you seen this?' Then he led me back to the bank of the river. As I went back, I saw on the bank of the river very many trees on the one side and on the other. And he said to me, 'This water flows towards the eastern region and goes down into Arabah and enters the sea. When the water flows into the sea, the water will become fresh. And wherever the river goes, every living creature that swarms will live, and there will be very many fish. For this water goes there, that the waters of the sea may become fresh, so everything will live where the river goes. Fishermen will stand beside the sea. From Engedi to Eneglaim, it will be a place for the spreading of nets. Its fish will be of very many kinds, like the fish of the great sea. But its swamps and marshes will not become fresh. They are to be left for salt. And on the banks, on both sides of the river, there will grow all kinds of trees for food. Their leaves will not wither, nor their fruit fail, but they will bear fresh fruit every month, because the water for them flows from the sanctuary. Their fruit will not be for food, so their fruit will be for food, and their leaves for healing." So Ezekiel's talking about the temple, and I believe that the temple he's talking about is us. Amen. 1 Corinthians 6:19 says that our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, whom we have from God. When we have the Spirit of God inside of us, we can speak the Word of God. Those words that we speak, the Word of God, are the water that creates the river. Luke 6:45 says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. When we speak faith-filled words, the water continues to pour. Proverbs 4:23 says, "Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flows the springs of life." That's the water that fills the river. And as you speak it and declare it, and you measure 1,000 cubits, it will be ankle deep. And you speak it and declare it some more, and you measure 1,000 cubits, it will be knee deep. And if you speak it and declare it some more, it will be deep until it's deep enough for you to swim in it. Some people might speak the word, fill the river, but will not get in. When you were a kid and you went to a lake or a pond, there was a tree with a tire hanging from a rope. And you would swing from that tire and jump in the water. And it was really fun. I've actually never done that. If that was fun, how much more fun it will be to jump in that river we just filled with our words. Let's go to the bank of the river and find a tree, tie a tire to a rope, swing from it, and jump in it. The dictionary defines river as a large natural stream of water flowing in a channel to the sea. Ezekiel says, and he said to me, this water flows toward the eastern region and goes down into the Arabah and enters the sea. When the water flows into the sea, the water will become fresh, and wherever the river goes, every living creature that swarms will live, and there will be very many fish. For this water goes there, the waters of the sea may become fresh, so everything will live where the river goes. So the water brings life to everything that's in it. John 4, verses 13 and 14 say, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again.
Amen.
The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. We have been given that water, and we have drank that water. We now have to fill the river so that it flows into the sea. I believe the sea Ezekiel is talking about is the world, the world that we live in. When the words, with the words that we speak, we introduce the world to Jesus, to the God of the Bible, the God we know and love, a God that provides for all our needs, that never leave us nor forsake us. So let's swim in that river and flow right into the sea and do what we have been instructed to do, make disciples of all the nations. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. Also, on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone has anything they want to share? Prayer request? Testimony? Okay, Tammy.
Good morning. The gal was out front this morning. Prayer for her. I told her that God loves her, doesn't want her life to be in turmoil, and that he wanted to bless her. And so I just prayed that that seed was planted, and she felt the love of God, and that everything works out for her. She's not even from here. So she was lost, didn't know where she was.
Teenage girl across the street from us, she's on the run from the law, she's been doing drugs, she's in another state right now, she can't come back to Iowa until she's at least 17, so just pray that she get, you know, would find a family of faith and get hooked up wherever she's at.
Yes.
Mike.
Mark just texted me. He's down in Burlington helping get his mom's stuff moved back in her house after the flood scare situation, but naturally it never happened because they declared it. But his friend Doug Kiesel's mom had a massive stroke, and needs total healing from that situation. He just texted me, so standing in the gap for Doug's mom.
Sheila.
Yeah, my daughter just called, and her eyes are all puffy and swollen this morning. I have no idea what to tell her to do or what to do, so call on the Lord.
Amen.
Pastor.
My brother-in-law, Richard, for healing.
Lift him up. I got an undisclosed request this morning also for a revival. So we'll keep that person. We'll lift them up too. Yes, Joe.
I have a testimony. Joan was riding her bike Friday night, and her and a couple of other girls, and we were at my brother's, so we were kind of parked out on the road. And they came around the last corner, which is kind of a hill. So she barbed it down this hill, didn't get turned, and she hit my car so hard that my son was in the back, kind of jumping on the trampoline.
to fill that river so we can jump in and swim in it and let that river carry us, Lord, to wherever it is that we need to go. We want to spread your word to this world, to introduce people to Jesus, to the God of the Bible. Our words, Lord, we speak because we have your spirit within us. Our words, we can heal the sick. So we declare the healing on those that are sick. We declare abundance on those that are in need. Breakthrough. Father, we declare that everything that's going on in the lives of those in this body, those outside, will be restored to its rightful place. In Jesus' name. We thank you, Father, for everything that you give us. For all the nations, Lord, for wanting to bring all of your children together. So announcements, we have Eastern Gate has a prayer this upcoming Friday. Pray that my mom can come all the way from Puerto Rico. Try to bring her. So if you can come, it is a really good time. All right, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I received the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant. And Abraham's blessings are mine. Toby and Peter, could you take the offering, please? And Toby, could you say the blessing? Let's worship the Lord. Yeah.
place of learning, teaching, and stretching. I've asked Roberto to lead, as he's going to be start leading more often. It's not about me. It's about him. It's about his kingdom and furthering on. So,
graduated elementary school.
And we don't have speed bumps in our school, so fly on, brother.
You know, as I was putting this worship together as being led by the Spirit, all I kept hearing was, let's praise him. Let's keep speaking everything he did for us. Not because he's a narcissist, but so that we can be reminded of how good he is.
Yes.
So, can you lead us, Mike, please?
Yeah, ready?
Eyes. Because that is who I am. I am a benevolent, loving, giving Father. I am your Savior. I myself came that you might know me, but the world did not recognize me. Those I came to save did not even recognize me. Now I said you. You need to show the world that I am good. Receive what I am freely giving you. Just give me thanks. Just give me thanks. And tell the world that I am good.
There are promises that have been given to many of us years gone by. And you may have thought, well, I've done this and I've done that. And I don't think I'm worthy of doing any of what I believe I've been called to do. You know, that's a lie from hell. Because Jesus did it all. We cannot do it on our own righteousness. Jesus did it all. He asked us to believe. He said we would do even greater things when he goes to the Father than when he was here on the earth. And we do that through his Holy Spirit who lives within us. How long will we let that kingdom just stay within inside of us? We talked about the river this morning, about, and I visually saw, we're on the eastern part of the city facing the east, and I seen the altar, as a lot of times we'll call this an altar area or whatever, and on the south side of the altar is where the river was running. Guess where you're standing right now? You are standing on the south side of that altar that was facing the east. You are in the river. Many of us try to keep our nose above the water line. Well, you know what? Just drown. Just drown in his presence. It is good. What is water made of? Oxygen and hydrogen. Okay? That's in the natural. If you break it apart, you could breathe it. Okay? The Lord wants to break some things inside of me so I can breathe correctly. I don't know if he's just talking to me or not, but that's between me, you, and the Holy Ghost. Whatever he wants to do. There are things that we've done in the past. There are things that we probably even did this morning on the way here with driving situations or attitudes at home. Okay? Just kick it to the curb. The Lord wants to deal with us right now. He wants to prepare this body right now. I know many are on vacation. Many are in other situations right now. But he is speaking to us that is here this morning. Okay? Let the gifts reign. Let the gifts come forth. There are those that can pray for others in this room right now. We're all called to be priests. If there's a need in this room, as Roberto was declaring out, if there are needs in this room, let the Holy Spirit reveal them to you, and you go and pray for that other person. You declare the words to that other person. You release the healing anointing to the other person. I don't care if you're 2 or if you're 90. It doesn't matter. The Lord is no respecter of persons. Anyone up here on this platform, sound booth, whatever, it doesn't matter where you are at. If the Lord is leading you to do ministry, do it. Do it.
I just keep seeing in my spirit that most, if not everybody here, is pregnant with a vision. And there's a problem, though, with a lot of them. There's three things that need to happen, and not everybody is. Everybody falls into one of these three camps. Some people are trying to force the vision they're pregnant with to give birth, and they're trying to force it along without God leading them and ahead of God's time or not within God's time. The second, there are a lot of visions within people that aren't being properly nurtured through prayer and worship, that they need to be praying for and worshiping so that the Lord, as they commit that vision to him, that he'll give birth to that through them. And then the third part is just those people that are afraid to give birth to their vision. Like Mike was saying, they have a vision. They actually haven't even told anybody about it. And they're afraid to tell somebody about it because they don't feel like they can do it or that it's not for them. And they're afraid to give birth what's in them. And so, you know, the Word of God tells us, you know, without a vision, people perish. But also it says hope deferred makes the heart sick.
Yes.
And a lot of people have lost hope. A lot of people feel that the vision they're pregnant with has died within them. Once again, that's a lie. And they need to commit each and every day to God, ask for his grace to do it, to give birth to this in his time, and to nurture it through prayer and worship, and continually just committing that to him. I mean, as much as you want to birth that vision within you, the Lord wants to birth it through you even more. But it's got to be through him. It can't be through you, because if you do it, you'll mess it up and you'll damage it. But the Lord, even if you've damaged the vision, the Lord can still repair that. But it's going to take his grace working through you to step out and see that accomplished.
And babies are birthed in water.
All the air. place, Lord. Let your kingdom come forth. Floating in the river of the Lord, worshiping, healing in his wings, Be filled with the Holy Ghost this morning. If you've never been filled with the Holy Ghost this morning, this is the time. This is the time. This is the place. Hallelujah. If you need a refreshing and refilling of the Holy Ghost, receive, 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 receive. Sing out, gentlemen.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your very word spoken, Lord, to me.
Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you for your word. You know, that's what the Lord said. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And that's the bread of life. Our spirit needs to be fed, maybe even more than our bodies need to be fed. And You know, the good thing about that is we often talk about, you know, we need to make ourselves hungry. But the truth is, you don't have to make yourself hungry in the natural. It just happens a couple, three times a day. And it's the same way in the spirit. God gives you a hunger for Him. Amen. I'm not talking about you're, you know, immersed in the Bible 24 hours a day. But there is a spiritual hunger that all of us have as children of God. And it's a hunger for Him. It's a hunger for His presence. A hunger for an awareness of God's interaction with us in our lives. Amen. And I'm grateful for that. Because it's God that does it. If it were left up to me, there'd be a lot of days go by between me and the pursuit of God. That's just the truth. Not because I don't love God or not because I'm not appreciative, but we can just get caught up in everything that we have going on in our life. But God keeps us in tune with Him. Amen? He keeps us hungering for Him. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank the Lord for His presence. Hallelujah. For His goodness and His mercy, as has already been spoken here this morning. He's a good God. He's good all the time. Amen. He knows nothing but good about you. I'm telling you the truth. If you are a believer, the only record God has of you is good. He doesn't have any other record. The rest of it all went as far as the east is from the west. Amen. Now, if that's not a good God, I just don't understand how you could define Him otherwise. Amen. He has declared us righteous. Amen. Because of His righteousness. Let's give Him a big hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Good job, Roberto. Everybody, God bless all the worship team. Appreciate their sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks to all of you who shared what the Holy Ghost was speaking to you. Praise the Lord. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Worshiping Him. And it was almost like He was saying, I have healed you. Healing can be a number of different things. So I'm just encouraging you guys, receive what
yes.
He has for you. Receive it.
Yes. Amen. In His presence, we spoke of this before, is fullness of joy.
Yes.
And at His right hand, amen, our pleasures forevermore. Wherever His presence is, there's supernatural ministry taking place. And our response to that has to be the same as it is to anything relative to God, and that's to believe, just to simply believe it. Yeah, Don.
I want to declare this morning that I have waited 51 years so far for a message when I was 17 years old that God told me would happen. Now, I stand here, and I declare, as though it were yesterday, that it will come to pass.
Yes.
Because God said it.
That's exactly right. That's right.
Because it is filthy rags. You better get a picture of this. It is filthy rags.
Mm-hmm.
The more you try to come to Him and be holy and pure, it's a joke to Him. You can't even begin to approach Him like that.
Amen.
The only way we can approach Him is through Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Yes.
The man that lived here and pleased the Father for us.
Yes.
But I think everything that is coming to pass. As we stood here, like Jody said, Lord, I reminded him, 51 years.
Yeah.
That's a long time. I'm getting old. And the Lord again said, as you look out and see all these things coming to pass, we're just about to the fullness of time. I want to tell you, yes, we have some movements of the Lord, you know, and we get excited. We're going to see things. We're going to see dead raised.
Yes, yes.
And the world's going to see it.
Amen.
They are going to know that Hallelujah. I will come when the world least expects it. They think he's dead.
Yep. Yep.
You know, the homosexuals got one of them. They're going crazy, and they think, I haven't been struck down yet. God's not, he must not care. Well, no, he is, I'm telling you what, the ark was full, the animals were on, all Noah's family was on 7 days. That thing stayed open. That's where we're in right now.
Yeah.
We're in the time that he's given the world, all the time in the world, but there comes a day. It's going to be off.
Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, I said Wednesday night, he said in the scripture, he says, by two immutable things that God cannot lie. Now, we covered all that Wednesday night. Those two immutable things are the same thing he promised Abraham, which is that you're going to be blessed and you're going to increase.
Yes.
Amen. Now, look, all we do is believe in that promise. He vowed a promise to himself. God swore to himself. The same thing to us, even more abundantly, the scripture says, than to Abraham, that he would bless us and increase us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Now, we've got to believe that.
Yes.
Amen. You've got to believe that you're blessed. You've got to believe that God's going to increase you, and that increase means everything. It means ministry. It means influence. It means how you can impact other people, the lost, you know, the saved that are unsure of their salvation or insecure about their salvation. Amen. And it's only and it's achieved and it's received one way, by believing in his promise. Now, God, look, he did it for Abraham. He brought it to pass for Abraham. The seed of God came through his lineage. Amen. And Abraham was the richest man. In fact, at one point, he was so rich that the people asked him to leave because his personal wealth was greater than the GDP of the country that he was in. And he was messing up their economy. So I'm not just talking about finances, but we should expect financial increase. We should expect to have more than enough. Amen. But you've got to expect it. You can't just resign yourself to, well, this is the way it's always been, or that's the job that I've got, or this is the only income I've got coming, or that's all I can provide. He's the provider. He's Jehovah Jireh. He can do things that you can't do. You just got to believe him for it. Amen. 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 If he said it to Jane, he's saying it to everybody in this room. Amen. Hallelujah. That's the way God sees us, as Don said and has been already spoken. He sees us as Jesus. He said, come boldly to the throne of grace. But he's already told us that we're seated there with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You just have to see yourself that way. God's going to do anything he ever said he was going to do. He's going to do it. He's got to do it, or he wouldn't be God. So we have to be willing. Abraham was promised, amen, that he was going to be the father of men. Now, he didn't have any kids. And the one that he did have, God said, he's not the one, Ishmael. He waited 20 years for that promise. And you got to imagine, even more kind of embarrassing, you might say, it was for Abraham, because everywhere he went, he was saying, I'm the father of multitudes. And they're going, and where does that start? You know, I mean, where? How?
Yeah.
So it was a constant kind of dig at Abraham every time he opened his mouth and introduced himself. Every time he said who he was, people would look at him like, oh, yeah? Really? Somebody missed the train, for this deal, because you don't have any kids. You're an old man. You're getting older. Your wife's never been able to have any kids, and she's 90 years old. And, so it's not going to happen. But the Bible says he refused to consider himself, his condition, her condition, whatever the rest of the world said about it, he refused to consider anything but what God had said. That's what we got to do. We got to consider what God says and forget about the rest of it. Just don't accept it. Don't receive it. Amen. I said before, there's facts and there's truth. Truth always prevails. It isn't that we're denying facts. We're just saying there's a truth that's greater than any fact. And that is whatever God has said must come to pass. It has to. It always has and it always will. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. I was thinking Wednesday night, somebody brought this up, and I won't say what the whole detail was because I don't want to embarrass anybody, but brought up the fact that sometimes we have loved ones, family, children, spouses, neighbors, friends, who don't really seem to be open about their faith. I mean, you wonder, do they really or don't they? I mean, do they believe or? When we know they believe, we know that they're believers, but their life really doesn't reflect it like we would like it to. Sometimes even our own. It was talked about here this morning even, how, you know, sometimes we're fearful. We'd like to do something, but we don't feel like we're qualified. We know ourselves too well. We feel like we'd blow it and be an embarrassment to God and all of that kind of stuff. Well, that's really what I want to talk to you about. The Lord, I hear a couple weeks ago, was talking to me about this, and I didn't quite get it at the time. I looked up a few things, and I used a little bit in a message I was preaching, but it kept coming back to me, and then Wednesday night when it was brought up, because look, like everybody else, I would like to see, you know, everybody that I'm connected with. I'm not talking about being radical, crazy, you know, in your face, quote unquote, Christians, but more secure in their, you know, their relationship, their whatever it is, you know. In other words, I guess I'm saying I'd like to see more something external, something that would make me feel better, you know. And that's what I want to talk to you about, though. Our way of looking at things, obviously, is not the way God looks at things. So I want to use a person who I think is really, really misunderstood. When we think about Joseph of Arimathea, or like Nicodemus, the Pharisee that came to him at night, I mean, that's kind of wimpy, and you think, what a, you know, come on, man up, you know, act like, you, well, never mind, praise the Lord, but, you know, just admit it, you believe. Yeah. Or Joseph of Arimathea is the one that really got my attention, because the Bible says he was afraid to admit that he believed for fear of the Jews.
Yeah.
So he just was a, you know, an undercover, you might say, Christian. Like a lot of people. He believed, but he never really let anybody else know that he believed. And that's what I want to talk to you about a little bit this morning. And so I want to read all of the brief references to him, because he is spoken of in each one of the Gospels. So that's what I want to start with this morning and just kind of go from there, and hopefully we can see some things about ourselves and about others the way God sees it, through God's eyes. Okay? Matthew, let's start with Matthew chapter 27, beginning at verse 57 through 60. There's the first record here of the man who was going to offer his grave to Jesus. When the even was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea, named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. Now, you wouldn't know that except for that right there. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus, and then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock, and he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulcher and departed. All right, and then in Mark chapter 15, verses 42 through 46. Now again, this shows some guts. The guy shows up to the guy who just had Jesus murdered. Now this is the guy who's afraid. That's why he hasn't admitted all in all this time that he was a Christian or that he was a believer. But now all of a sudden, out of the woodwork, this guy comes right up to the Roman leader who had declared, in agreement with the Jewish priests to put Jesus to death. And he comes right up to this guy and asks for the body. So again, here in Mark is another version. And now when the even was come, because it was preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, and also which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead. And calling unto him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead. And when he knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. And he brought fine linen and took him down and wrapped him in the linen and laid him in a sepulcher which was hewn out of a rock and rolled a stone unto the door of the sepulcher. Amen. Again, this is this coward who has been unwilling to admit that he was a believer in Christ at all, and now all of a sudden, this stuff. Amen. Luke chapter 23, verse 50 through 53. Behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor, and he was a good man and a just. The same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. This man went unto Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And he took it down and wrapped it in linen and laid it in a sepulcher that was hewn in stone, wherein never man before was laid. All right? John, this is the last, John 19, verses 38 through 42. And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100-pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jew is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulcher, wherein was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulcher was nigh at hand. Praise the Lord. Okay? So, this Joseph of Arimathea, obviously based on these scriptures, we know that Jesus was buried in his tomb. And he's spoken of, as we just read, in each one of the Gospels. And then he disappears. Never hear another thing about him. So, I knew the name, but I didn't know much about the guy. I thought he was just a sidebar, not really worth spending a whole lot of time studying or trying to find out anything about him, right? Mm-hmm. I knew he was a disciple. I knew that he'd asked for Jesus' body, and I knew that Jesus was put in his tomb.
Right.
But what I found was I had missed something incredibly important. I'd never noticed what kind of a disciple he was. He was the disciple that none of us want to be. I'm talking about prior to this incident. He was a secret disciple. He was a scared disciple. He was a phony disciple. Praise the Lord. If you read his story, which we just looked at the highlight of the end of the thing, and you compare all four of these gospel accounts, it's obvious that if he were alive today and we didn't know this end of his story, most of us would write him off as a loser, a coward, a lousy Christian, if in fact he even was a Christian. I mean, you know what I'm saying? That's what we'd say, because you don't see him here. He's not openly letting people know that he's a believer. He's not doing what we think a believer should do and be, right? So most of us would just write him off, and he'd be in religious circles, at least, for sure. He'd be the poster child for a counterfeit disciple. Amen? He's exactly the kind of Christ follower that most preachers ridicule and warn us not to be like. Amen? Now, speaking about what constitutes a genuine Christian, you got, I mean, I grew up in the faith. I'm not talking about from a child, but from the time I was born, this is what I understood. This is what I heard. This is, generally speaking, what was preached. So was Jesus coming to let the riffraff in or to keep the lukewarm out? Praise the Lord. Usually, it's a contest to see who's willing to give up the most to follow Jesus. Now, I can remember sitting in a lot of revivals, because we were from a large church, Southeast Texas, Bible Belt. We had, well, I don't know, 2-3 revivals a year, at least. And I can tell you, some of these guys were great, but a lot of them would spend as much time telling you how much they had given up to go into the ministry, how much they had sacrificed to be an evangelist or whatever, to somehow impress us that, you know, they were really following Jesus. They really sacrificed everything, you know, to do this ministry thing. Hallelujah. But the question follows then, that means that so there's no relationship with Jesus unless he has our absolute, undivided, exclusive affection. Amen? Absolute, undivided, exclusive. Yep. Praise the Lord. Now, wouldn't it be nice if that were true? But if that's true, there's going to be a lot of Christians in hell. Yep. I mean, a lot of Christians are going to be in hell. Look at Mark chapter 10. And verse 17. And I'm going to show you the kind of scriptures that most of us are used to seeing and hearing when it comes to following Jesus. When he was gone forth into the way, there came one running, kneeled to him, and asked him, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" But Jesus said, give away everything, basically. Amen. Sell everything you got. Take up your cross and follow me. Now, there are lots of things we can do with this. First of all, the guy put himself in this position because he asked what he could do. Sure. Instead of what had been done or what was being done for him to be saved, he asked, what I got to do? Jesus said, well, if you want it on those terms, here's what you got to do. Yeah. You got to give everything up. Take up your cross. Yeah. Because mine ain't going to do you any good if you're wanting to know what you're supposed to do. Yeah. Right? So we read things out of context in the first place, religiously speaking. But even so, we'll just leave that. Then there's a guy who says, I'd like to follow you, but he said my dad's dying, and I need to wait for him to die before I can come and follow you. And Jesus said, well, let the dead bury their dead. You come follow me. Now, again, it looks harsh. It looks really cruel. And we love that as religious people. We love to just beat people over the head with this. Yeah. Let them die and come on. They're not believers. They're dead. Yeah. Come follow. Get on the wagon, you know. But The truth is, Jesus was actually quoting from a parable that he told before about the wedding supper, where this king had invited everybody to come to dine at this feast for his for this wedding. And everybody made excuses. I got to buy a cow. I got to, you know, pick out a bride. I got to go look at a truck. I got to, you know, I'm thinking about buying a house. We got to deal with the realtor. I mean, everybody had an excuse. Praise the Lord. And that's what Jesus is really dealing with. He's not dealing with don't care about your parents, don't care about somebody dying. I mean, that would be totally insane to think that based on what we know about Jesus. But we do, that's what we do. As religious people, as people that want everybody to just come on and put your nose to the grindstone, take up your cross, and let's get with this program. Let's be Christians.
Yeah.
Amen? So, amen. He told this guy, wait. He said, waiting's not an option. Let somebody else bury him and let's go. Take up your cross daily. Amen? Come on, this is you need to be sacrificing. You need to really be putting something into this thing if you're really going to be a believer, a follower of Jesus. Amen? Problem is, Jesus said some other things too.
Yep.
He also said some things that those preachers usually don't talk about much. He healed this fearful woman. Now, the scripture says, and I just looked it up again this morning, about the woman with the issue of blood. It says she fell down afraid and trembling at Jesus' feet. She was frightened. And Jesus said, daughter, your faith has made you whole. He could have said, you Gentile, you have no business here, not to mention the fact that we're still under the law and you've got this bloody issue, which you're unclean and should have no interaction with anybody, least of all the Son of God. But he didn't. He just said, your faith has made you whole.
That's right.
He praised her for her faith instead of rebuking her for her fear. He knew that Peter was going to deny him, but he kept him around anyway.
Yep.
He even pursued him personally afterwards.
Right.
He went out of his way to show doubting Thomas
the
truth. Not to ridicule him, but to help him overcome his doubt. We read it as doubting Thomas. Well, doubting Thomas, Jesus made a point to come to doubting Thomas and show him something that would increase his faith, something that would overcome the doubts that he had. And Jesus encouraged crowds of people that were wore out with their spiritual burdens and their religious rules and rituals to come to him for rest, to come to him for a lighter load and an easier yoke.
Yep.
And to many, that is compromised today. To a lot of the religious world, that is what they like to call consumer Christianity. And they mock people like myself or you or anybody else who doesn't want to just rub it in the face of every believer who isn't as geared up and on fire and nose to the grindstone and all that kind of stuff as they'd like you to believe they are.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, it's a mistake to interpret Jesus' strongest and harshest statements in a vacuum. It might make for powerful sound bites, but it makes for lousy theology. Let's look at, again, Mark chapter 10 and verse 21. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. This is the rich young ruler we were talking about earlier.
Right.
Jesus loved him and said unto him, one thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me. So I'm not getting into all the depth of that and what it means. There's plenty to be preached from there. But whatever it means to take up our cross and follow Jesus, we can't take a few of Jesus' statements and turn them into a global assignment,
right,
and a responsibility for every person who believes.
Right.
It's just not scriptural.
Right.
We have to interpret his words in light of the totality of Scripture. You can dig out things that make God look angry and mean and spiteful and everything else, but if you take the totality of the Bible, you've got to see that God is good. He's good all the time. It may not look like, you know, the way things are worded, the way we have interpreted and understood things. You might find places where people can argue, oh, God did kill this person, killed that and did this and all. And in fact, when you look at the entire resource of the Word of God, you've got to see God is good.
Amen.
To see him otherwise is to misinterpret him. That's why when Jesus showed up, they didn't recognize him.
Right.
He showed up and he's going about doing good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they said he's from the devil.
Yeah.
So we've got to interpret the Word in light of the totality of Scripture. And that's why the story of Joseph of Arimathea is so important, because it's paradigm busting. It really is. If you're coming from a religious background and a legalistic kind of approach, this thing will freak you out and ruin your approach.
Uh-huh.
It'll mess you up. Amen? Because it messes with so much of our preconceived notions about Jesus. It messes with our preconceived ideas about discipleship and what it means to please God.
Yeah.
And what kind of person does God use?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, if you haven't sacrificed everything. You know, if you didn't give up the six-figure income or, the glory of whatever your position was and everything else to come and serve the Lord, well, then you haven't. I can honestly tell you, I got nothing but good out of this. Everything got better for me. I mean, I didn't give up anything that I wouldn't have gladly burnt to the ground had I known what I could have had long before. So as I said, I always thought that this Joseph, amen, as a bit player, you know, kind of just in the resurrection narratives is what we understand it. So in my mind, the key players were the people that were directly involved. You know, the disciples that we know of, the 12, and the high priest, and Pilate, and Mary, you know, these people, you know, were the key players that were directly involved in the death and the resurrection. And Jesus' burial was just the kind of connecting point between the two. You know, it was like a conjunction in a long sentence. You've got to stick something in there to pull it all together to make it, you know. And that's kind of the way I thought about Joseph of Arimathea. He was just kind of a conjunction in this before his death, his burial, and then his resurrection. He was just kind of an afterthought, kind of just in there, you know. It didn't make a whole lot of sense to me. It didn't really seem all that important even. But Joseph and his tomb were necessary. But in the same way that this kind of extension of a sentence, you need to put a conjunction in there to make it come together, make it flow.
Right?
Right? So that's because I assumed that dead bodies are always buried someplace. Mm-hmm. I mean, what's the big deal? He's going to go in a hole somewhere.
Yeah.
Right.
He's got to be buried. It's what you do with dead bodies, right?
Yeah. Right?
But nothing could be further from the truth. Because in that day, in that time that Jesus lived, a body of a criminal wasn't buried. It was dumped in the dunghill. It was dumped in a garbage place. And it was left for jackals and vultures and other scavengers to deal with. Now, it's hard for us to believe that, but that's exactly how it worked. If you were a criminal, that was the end for you. That's A dog would drag you off. We used to joke about that. I don't care how they bury me. Just stick a meat skin in me and throw me in the ditch and the dogs will drag me off. Hallelujah. That's a Marine Corps kind of thing. Amen. But the truth is, they don't do that here. Here, you got to be buried or cremated or something has to be done with that body. They're not going to just throw it off in a field someplace and wait for the fox and the wolves and the whatever else to come along and the turkey vultures and to pick you apart like they do the roadkill along the street. So no Joseph of Arimathea, no body to resurrect. No empty tomb to point to say he's risen. He was in there, but he's not in there anymore. Right? And in fact, it fulfills prophecy. Let's look at Isaiah 53 and verse 9. Talking about the suffering servant and how he would be buried in a rich man's tomb. God doesn't leave anything to chance. And he made his grave with the wicked. In other words, he died with the criminals. And with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Amen? And it talks about a borrowed tomb and so forth, the tomb of a rich man, which is not what should have been. He should have been out there in the garbage dump with the criminals. But because he did no wicked thing, God saw to it that he was buried in the tomb of a rich man. Praise the Lord. So not only was Joseph an unappreciated hero, amen, he was also an unlikely hero. Let's look again at Mark chapter 10, verse 28 this time. Then Peter began to say unto him, Lo, we've left all and have followed thee. Peter, this is Peter. Come on, Lord. We've given up everything to follow you. This is all about you, Jesus. We've sacrificed everything to follow you. Right? But here's what's interesting. All of the hardcore Jesus followers who had left everything to follow him are nowhere to be found when Joseph shows up. The scared guy, the secret disciple, the hypocrite, you could say, the phony, the lousy disciple. These are the guys that religion points to as examples of what it means to be a radical follower of Jesus. But in the darkest moment, when everything seemed lost and the committed showed no commitment, it was only the frightened Joseph, amen, when all the courageous aren't showing any courage, it's this frightened, fearful, secret disciple who steps up to the plate and demands the body from the people that killed it. It makes me hesitant, amen, to pat myself on the back for any sacrifice I may have felt I've ever made or given. It's like they say in the investing world, past performance is no guarantee of future results. It's amazing then that Jesus' hand-picked disciples bailed out immediately as soon as the crap hit the fan. As soon as it got bad, they bailed. So we need to ask ourselves, can any of us fully claim to completely take up our cross, denying self and loving him above life itself? If truth be told, none of us has a devotion that is as absolute, undivided, or exclusive as we may like to think that it is. Even people who declare that only that kind of devotion is acceptable for a genuine disciple come far short of it themselves. So it also makes me hesitant to call out, to write off, or to tear apart those who struggle with full devotion and reckless abandonment.
Yeah.
Who am I to blast a secret disciple as unworthy if Jesus didn't?
Come on now.
I might have my preferences. I'd like to have some people that are close to me, that I know, that I care about, that I love, that are friends, that are family, whatever, be more up front. But who am I to question them if Jesus doesn't? It's my desire. It's my, make me feel good. But Jesus isn't asking for that. Who am I to write off the not yet fully committed if Jesus didn't write them off? I'm not saying I don't want people to be committed. I'm just saying, look, come on. We know the real world is everybody's not committed this way. And we cannot write them off. And we shouldn't be wringing our hands and fearful that God, somehow God is not going to have nothing to do with them. When God was committed to Joseph, even if Joseph wasn't committed to him. Because he knows the end from the beginning. Who am I to say that God can't use the kind of people that he actually uses? They don't have to have, you know, the pen that shows that they didn't miss Sunday school for 20 years. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not trying to belittle commitment. I'm just saying God uses people that we never dreamed that he would use. We don't think it's right that he should use them. They haven't sacrificed enough. They haven't invested enough. They don't even admit that they are a Christian half the time. They don't have a bumper sticker. Praise the Lord. Amen. Honk if you love Jesus. And they're, who are these idiots? Always on the horn. So I just wonder if religious efforts to purify the church aren't more Pharisaical than they are Christian. We want to fix everybody. You know, we're going to get them straightened out, and we're going to have them committed, and they're going to be on fire for God, or bless God, they'll go somewhere else. Well, bye-bye, because they will. Amen? Jesus wasn't doing that. He was embracing them. He was loving them. Uncommitted as they might have been. Inconsistent as they often were. And he loved them anyway. Look at Matthew chapter 12, verse 20. Hallelujah. We're about finished here. Hang in here with me, praise the Lord. Won't be long. A bruised reed shall he not break, and a smoking flax shall he not quench, till he send forth judgment unto victory. Praise God. When it comes to bruised reeds, when it comes to smoldering wicks, amen, and weary saints, religious people don't have any patience. Pharisees do not have patience for people like that. They pile heavy burdens and lots of guilt and more shame and fear. But they don't lift a finger to do anything to help this thing be easier. Seems like from a religious perspective, that sounds almost blasphemous to say that we should try to make it easier. But that is exactly what Jesus was doing. That's exactly what he preached. All ye that are laboring and heavy laden, come, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke. It's easy. Come on. This is coming from God. My way's easy. It's this religious thing that's really difficult. He's trying to make a definitive difference between what they understood religion to be and what he was trying to bring to this religious world and to the unbeliever. Look, it's altogether different than you've supposed. It's easy. I'm doing it all. Take my yoke. The yoke is his. I'm pulling. I'm doing the lifting. I'm doing all the heavy work here. All you got to do is come along. Just follow me. However that is. You hear what I'm saying? I mean, I almost feel apologetic because I've got this so steeped in me, you know, that it almost makes me uncomfortable to say, you don't have to do anything. It's like they used to say, you know, if the Holy Ghost is like a cat, and you can rub it either way, but most of us are rubbing it the wrong way and wondering why it's so irritable or seems to be irritable. Now, I don't know about you, if anybody ever got a cat, but, you know, they're not crazy. They won't sit still very long for you rubbing the fur the wrong direction. You know, they all of a sudden you'll learn about 10 new things about cats, praise the Lord, and just by that. That, they'll sit there all afternoon and try to get in your face and everything else. But the Holy Spirit, it only goes one way, the right way, God's way. How much we want it to be some other way, we're not going to make it work that way. He goes the way of the Lord. He goes the way that only the Spirit of God can go. So they don't do anything. They find all kinds of reasons for you to do more, but they don't do anything to help you to do those things. But that's not the way it is with Jesus. The bruised reed he will not break. The smoldering wick he won't snuff out. To the weary and the heavy laden and heavy burdened, he offers rest. A light load. An easy yoke. Yes. Yes. This is revelation. The beauty of the story of Joseph of Arimathea is that it shows a compassion and a patience and a grace in the face of Jesus. Instead of this, take up your cross and follow me. Leave everything. Let them bury the dead. That's the impression that we kind of get because they're trying to make him fit their misconceptions of God in the Old Testament. Hallelujah. And here we have a God in the flesh who's being compassionate, who's being patient, who's being graceful to the struggling saint. To the believer who's struggling with his believing. Who believes, but he's afraid that there's consequences for this belief. Could be negative. May not put me in the best light with some people. I don't know how to express it. Maybe I'll be humiliated or I'll humiliate the message I'm trying to express. So I'm just not going to say anything because I'd rather do that than make a fool out of myself or make God look like an idiot. Joseph was the ultimate smoldering wick. Yes. Praise the Lord. And a lot of Christians would have been tempted to snuff him out. Just like we think about some people who are not here today, who we feel like should be here today, and I wish they were here today, don't get me wrong. But I'm not snuffing them out because they're not here. I'm not writing them off because they don't have the same commitment, quote unquote, that I might have. Or that you might have. Thank God you're here. Thank God you come. Thank God for everybody that does get involved. But we cannot write off those who don't operate on the same wavelength as us because Jesus doesn't write them off. He doesn't snuff out the wick. Amen. He doesn't quench that flame. He fanned the flame.
Yes.
He kept it alive.
Yes.
And eventually, I believe it's true of all of us. It's true of God's promises to us, but it's also true of individual faith. He kept it alive, and eventually the time came when Joseph's little flame burned brighter than all of these others that we thought should have been the thing. That we would have expected God's going to use them mightily, and then here comes along this kind of, well, I think I'll go to church today. You know, or I think I'll just pray for my neighbor. And bang! God heals somebody of cancer, or some supernatural, miraculous thing happens from somebody who we would have never expected, because we weren't even sure they really were committed at all. We weren't even sure that they really had any faith. But Jesus knows the end from the beginning, and he's willing to be long-suffering. He's willing not to blow out that flame or to quench the wick. Amen? He can use people we don't think are usable. He, in fact, loves using those people. Praise the Lord. As long as the wick smolders, there's always hope. We can be like Jesus and we can fan the flame. Or we can stomp it out as unworthy, as useless, as embarrassing to God, because they've got some other things they're doing that we don't think maybe quite fit the paradigm for what God does and doesn't do. Oh man, we've got it so screwed up. I mean, most of us have just got the idea so wrong. Praise the Lord. The choice is still ours. We're the body of Christ. All I can say is, in the case of Joseph, it's a good thing that the flame-stomping crowd didn't get to him first. Oh, we'd have had a really messed up Easter. Can you say amen?
Yes.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Praise the Lord. So the next time you're dealing with friends, family, loved ones who maybe don't seem to be as locked in, don't write them off. Just love them. Just appreciate the faith that they do have, the belief that they have in Christ. And I think we're all going to be surprised how God's going to bring about such a transformation in people's lives, that those that have been a little timid maybe, a little hesitant, are going to be so bold in the end that they'll stand up and declare the truth of God to anybody without fear of consequences. Just let them do it in God's time. You just keep fanning the flame. Just keep them, amen, in faith. Just keep them in a place where they feel okay. That it's okay not to be everything that I am today. But encourage them. And let God deal with them individually the way he has with each one of us. Let him produce Christ in them. We can't do that. We can make images of us. And God knows we don't need any more Nathans. We need more Jesus. And only God can produce that in a person. Our responsibility is to encourage them, to love them, to accept them, and allow the love of God, the compassion of God, to nurture them and bring them to a place of boldness and courage where they can stand up and say, as a matter of fact, I am a Christian. So what? If you knew Jesus the way I know Jesus, you'd want to be a Christian too. The problem is all you've known is religion. And it's not that pretty. Praise the Lord. But Jesus is a loving Father. Just like we love our kids even when they act up. I can remember pretending like my dad wasn't my dad at times. Ooh, he was embarrassing. He was just... I mean, you know what I'm saying. I didn't deny he was my father, but I wasn't going to say, hey, Dad, when he was having one of these tantrum things going on. I just kind of, geez, I don't know who that guy is. He's really flipping out, isn't he? Poor old fool. You know what I mean? But that's kind of, that's us. We're embarrassed. We get embarrassed. Jesus is never embarrassed. I mean, he had plenty of reason to be embarrassed. Me. Amen? But he's never embarrassed. In the middle of anything, he'll come right up to me and say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. As embarrassing as he might be, to the religious people. He's still my son. He's still my child. I still love him. And that's the way we've got to see people. Be like Jesus in that respect. It's one thing we can do. We can love them. We can accept them. We can't live a perfect life like Jesus did, but we can reflect that perfection in grace to other people. And it's all up to him anyway. He does the saving. Think about it. This is amazing to me. Whose sins you forgive, I forgive.
Yes.
You think of the responsibility, the power that God has given us to forgive. And who we forgive, he forgives. He gives us that kind of power. So I'd say we need to do a whole lot more forgiving and a lot less condemning. Amen. If we want this world to see Jesus. And if we want to see those timid, kind of fearful Christians to become bold, they need to know that it's okay to fail.
Yeah.
And God will still use you.
Yeah.
In fact, God's wanting to use you to show his power and his anointing and his glory through failures.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Tammy?
That's kind of what I saw during worship. I saw each one of us, and I heard the Lord, I saw each one of us just, all I saw was like our hand, everyone just reaching out a hand. And I just heard the Lord say that each one just loved somebody, just forgave somebody, just reached out to somebody. There will be more people in here than we could ever imagine.
About this, we've had, it's not an accident that some woman in distress, God only knows what's going on in her life, but it's, I'm sure, chaotic and dysfunctional, or otherwise her boyfriend wouldn't have dumped her in the middle of nowhere and hiding out in some house. But it's not an accident that she ends up in our parking lot, lost. It's not an accident that the week before we've got some other guy out here on the front step, and the week before that, another, a different one, homeless, kind of not got it all together. And God's wanting to see, what are you going to do? Are you going to do what I would do?
Amen.
You know, are you going to extend a hand to them? Are you going to show them respect? Even though in the natural we'd say, well, they don't deserve respect. I mean, after all, look, they don't want a job. They don't want to do this. They're drunk. They're high. They're messed up. Whatever. God respects every life. He gave that life in spite of how we use it, you know. But what he wants to know is more about us than about them. He already knows where they're at, but he wants to know, how do we relate to them?
Yeah.
Can we respect them? You don't have to like what it is that's going on in their life, but you can still respect the fact that that's a human being that God died for, and be willing to do whatever you can do. It doesn't mean you got to give them $1 million. If you got a couple of bucks you can afford to give them. That's what we've done. We've just said, look, this is not charity. We're not asking for a pat on the back. This is Jesus. This is just from Jesus to you. Just forget about it. You don't need to come back here and come to church. You're welcome to, but you're not under any obligation. You don't have to come and pay me back when you get a job. You don't have to feel like I got to go buy a hamburger instead of a pint. It's yours. You do whatever you want to with it. It's yours. And likewise, somebody's out here just showing them that somebody cares who's not going to get anything in return. The woman is fortunate enough to get home. She's going to be in Illinois.
Yeah.
But she might just remember that somebody who didn't need to do anything for me took the time to help me. And hopefully they'll see the connection between that and Jesus. That's all we're trying to do. If we do that, we're successful.
Yes.
If we do that, we've ministered.
Yes.
Now, you might not have seen the sky open. You might not have got a vision. You might not have heard an audible voice. But you've been more like Jesus in that moment than all of the other involved.
Amen.
And the other thing is, when we do what we can do, he'll do what we can't do.
That's right.
Exactly.
When we do the simple things of just caring about people, loving people, then God will do the supernatural that we're not capable of.
Amen?
Hallelujah. God bless all of you. Amen. Enjoy this week and enjoy the love of God. Relax about those that aren't quite where we are.
Yeah.
Trust God.
Yeah.
He's going to use them, and he's going to use them mightily before this is all over with. Amen? Because that's what God does. Hallelujah. God bless you. Have a tremendous week. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord. Amen.